Energy growth directly equates to economic growth. The biggest problem that we have today is this 1.5 billion people who are out of grid and out of luck. You heard Bill Gross talk about when there's a grid, when you have the plant, what to do. What about the places where there's no grid? For them, when we leapfrog, we want to look for a clean solution, because anywhere in the world you provide clean power, you will automatically be able to provide clean water and clean air. And when those three things are done, the standard of living, the actual standard of living of somebody goes up. So that's the key. What we have today, the way we produce energy mostly, is mired by pollution and politics. Pollution simply means that the developed world does not want to put extra capacity. Politics simply means the people that don't have it will not have it because they're the have-nots. So we have this big disparity between the energy haves and the energy have-nots. And if that paradigm is not broken fundamentally by how we generate energy and getting power to the people who are out of the grid but not out of luck, then we have a real issue. And that real issue is there are two roads, one to wealth and one to poverty. To be able to eliminate that, you really not only need to be off the grid, but the fuel used for off the grid needs to be democratic. What that means is that the fuel needs to be local. The device Bloom builds will be agnostic to the kind of fuel, and it'll be local fuel, number one. Number two, we can't afford to have this centralized connected system, which is waste in multiple ways. The capital infrastructure, the infrastructure, and the losses that occur through this structure all create waste. And that, if you can eliminate, would be the right way to go. Has that happened before? It's happened in computing. It's happened in telecom. You can see that the reason a fishing lady in Bangladesh has a phone and walks around is because it's a wireless phone and not a copper wire line that needs to flow in. So the path for development really is distributed with fuel that's also local to where it comes from. I started doing this for Mars, to make Mars a sustainable planet. Found out that the Martians didn't want to pay me good money, so you know, came to Earth and started figuring out how to figure sustainability here. The big issue here then is fuel cells, which is it is a solid oxide fuel cell. It's a high temperature fuel cell, and it's built as a flexible platform, very much like a Swiss Army knife. The input has to be agnostic to what kind of fuel. The output has to be agnostic to AC, DC, low voltage, high voltage, electricity, or hydrogen. Those have to be the combinations. When you're able to do that, the way we are able to do that is to take beach sand, make very cheap materials that don't have any expensive noble materials. Number one, affordability. Number two, this sand can conduct oxygen across it and not hydrogen. So we don't need hydrogen as a fuel, which was a big problem for all the other kinds of fuel cells. So as long as there is air flowing in through it, any form of fuel that has either a carbon or a hydrogen voraciously reacts with it. So you can go from biogas to biofuel to switchgrass to even taking intermittent power and running our system in reverse to break the water, store the hydrogen when the sun is not shining, reverse it, produce the electricity. So you're able to produce either electricity or hydrogen as a storage. So it's both a electricity generator as well as an electricity storage device. When you're able to do that, then you've really created that flexible platform that becomes a home energy server, a building energy server. And the future of transportation, we don't want the fuel cell in the vehicle. We want it to be the gas station to the fuel, so to speak, either hydrogen or electrons going into a battery that you'll be hearing about. So that's the model that we see the world going. When you do this, you've democratized fuel, you've democratized the infrastructure, you simply have a grid to go. You don't need to go where the grid is. The grid comes to where you are, so to speak. And that is real liberation. That is redefining. That is rethinking. And that's the box that Bloom's building. And here, again, if you look at it, it's not just for the developing world. Every bright spot is the developed world. In the developed world, we care about energy security, reliability. In the developing world, they care about access and affordability. Our technology is able to do both. Thank you very much.